in tropical forests, especially in shaded areas where the temperatures don't vary that much. So let's look at thermoregulators in a little detail. So this y-axis is the temperature, x-axis is the time of the day, and these ranges of temperatures are the temperatures within which the lizards are very active and the temperatures which the lizards really like. These temperatures, consider this temperature in the open, like it can vary a lot from super cold to super hot. And consider this as the temperature of refuge here, something like a burrow or under a rock or under the shade or something like that. So what thermoregulators will do is that they'll use these micro habitats to maintain their body temperature within the temperature they like. This is known as a preferred temperature or T-set. But what will happen to these thermoregulators if the temperatures were to increase in the future, which they most certainly will as per many studies? The time within which they're active will reduce, of course, because they'll run back to their refuge and they'll stay there for a longer time. So this is something known as activity restriction. So they'll spend more time inside their refugia. So they won't be able to do normal lizard things like foraging or finding mates or territory defense and so on. So they'll be restricted to their refuge. And due to this, Cinero in his very famous paper predicted that around 29.2% of agamids will go locally extinct and 27% of agamids will go completely extinct. And in this slide, I did my master's research using lab methods and field methods to evaluate the thermal ecology of the spiny-tailed lizard, also Sara Hardwicki, and its vulnerability to climate warming. The objectives of my study were to understand how this lizard thermoregulates in this harsh desert environment. I also wanted to evaluate the current sprint performance, which is a proxy for the fitness of the lizard and how it varies across various temperatures and projected to future scenarios. I wanted to quantify the number of hours for which the lizard is currently restricted to its refugia and projected to future scenarios. So I worked in the Thar landscape of Rajasthan, which is the hottest part of this lizard's distribution. And my study sites were these two plots, 1 hectare plots, one inside the desert national park and one outside the national park. This is how the two sites look like. I wanted to cover a wide array of landscapes in which these lizards exist, so I chose these two sites, which are completely different. Now, something about the lizard. The lizard is an obligate burrower. It's a herbivore, which predominantly feeds on grasses. It goes under a hibernation every winter, and it's found in the arid and semi-arid regions of India, Pakistan, and Afghanistan. So a little about the morphology of the lizard, which I'll be using in further analysis. So I quantified the morphology for 49 lizards. I measured its mass, snout to wing length. I identified the sex of the lizard. I identified if the female was gravid or not using abdominal palpations. And I quantified the body condition index using this formula. This is the mass. This is the SVL of the whole population. This is the SVL of the individual. And this exponent is the slope between log mass and log SVL. So the relationship between log SVL and log mass was very strong. So I only used log SVL for my further analysis. Now, the first question that I wanted to answer was whether the lizard was a thermoregulator or a thermoconformant. And if it was a thermoregulator, how does its thermoregulation vary monthly? To do so, I quantified the body temperature of 19 lizards from March to May. So I attached these little eye buttons to the lizard in this cotton harness and marked the lizard with a non-toxic felt tip marker. And I monitored the individuals between 20 to 61 days. This led me to get around 65,950 body temperature data points across the seasons. This data was collected at a 15-minute interval, and I used skin temperature as a proxy for cold temperature. And I also quantified, so remember this is the first thermal variable that I'll be recording, which is the voluntary thermal maxima. So consider this as the temperature at which the lizards run back to their burrows. So this is the thermal threshold which is usually used in the field. Then I calculated the operative temperatures. So what are operative temperatures? Imagine you are placing a lizard in the open for 24 hours without any kind of thermoregulation. The temperature that it will experience in that period of time is the operative temperature in the open. And same for burrows. So if you keep the lizards in the burrow for 24 hours without any kind of thermoregulation, that'll be the operative temperature inside the burrow. So to do so, I used these biophysical models, also known as copper models, which emulate the size, posture, and the shape of the lizard, and I placed them inside three different microhabitats, one in the open, one at the burrow entrance, and one meter deep inside the burrow. So I used two of these models, one for adult, one for juvenile, and I placed these thermal loggers inside the core of this model. And then I used the body temperatures and the operative temperatures to estimate the activity of the lizard. To do so, I constructed two data sets. One was based on observation, this was my test data set. And for observations, I did focal animal sampling in this hide, and I identified the individuals which are already marked using focal animal sampling, and I noted down their activity at that particular time from 7 a.m. to 8 p.m., 10 days a month spread over the whole month. Then I looked at the daily peaks and troughs of body temperature. So these major troughs and peaks were considered as inactive and active. So this was lizard in the open and this was lizard inside its burrow. Then I created a simple algorithm using if-then-else algorithm, and I saw if the body temperatures were nearer to operative temperatures in the open, then the lizard was classified as being active. And if the body temperatures were nearer to operative temperatures in the burrow, then the lizard was classified as being inactive. Okay, then for results of this question, what I got is that this lizard, Sara Hardwicki, is definitely a thermoregulator, because the slope between the operative temperature in the open and the body temperature was 0.1, which is minimal. So these lizards are thermoregulating very actively. And this would be the slope if this lizard were a thermoconformer, which it definitely is not. Then if you look at monthly thermoregulation, these are temperatures in the open and these are the body temperatures. So in March they are somewhat similar, but as you see, as the months progress, there's a significant difference between the two. And the VT max that I talked about turned out to be 46.3 degrees Celsius. So after this temperature, the lizards will run back to their refugia because it's too hot for them. Now, these are my results from the if-else algorithm. What I got is, the activity was higher in March compared to April and May, and the proportion of activity in April and May was almost similar. But if you look at the daily patterns month-wise, what you'll see is the activity is becoming more and more bimodal, because the temperatures in the afternoon are too high for the lizard. So in May it's very bimodal, whereas in March it's kind of unimodal, with lizards being more active in the evening. Other thermal limits. So this was what I did in the field. Then I did some experiments to answer some questions which can only be answered in the lab. For that, I again captured 20 lizards and I acclimatized them for 24 hours before doing any kind of experiments. And all experiments were done within from 7 a.m. I mean from 8 a.m. to 7 p.m., which is usually their active period. The first question that I wanted to answer is, what are the temperatures that the lizard really likes? To do so, I created this thermal gradient from 25 degrees Celsius to 52 degrees Celsius using an infrared lamp. Then a lizard was released in the middle of this gradient with a thermal cloacal thermometer attached to it. And then the lizards were free to roam around in the gradient for 3 hours. And the data for last hour, the 25% to 75% interquartile range of that data was considered as the preferred temperature range, which turned out to be 38.2 degrees Celsius to 40 degrees Celsius. Next question that I wanted to answer is, what is the maximum temperature that these lizards can take without dying? So to do so, I placed these lizards inside these metal containers and a 150 watt infrared lamp was placed 40 centimeters above the lizards, so as to heat them at a 1 centigrade per minute rate, because the rate of heating is also very important. And then I observed the lizards constantly, and whenever I observed muscular spasms, I took out the lizards and put them outside to cool. And the temperature at which I observed spasms was denoted as CT max, or the critical thermal maximum, which was 49 degrees Celsius, which is super high, but it's understandable since the lizards are found in these harsh environments. Now, another thing I wanted to look at was the fitness of the lizard. How does the fitness of the lizard vary with different temperatures? For that, I use locomotive performance or sprint performance as a proxy. I also wanted to look at the temperature at which the speed of the lizard is maximum, and also the B95 range, which is the range of temperatures within which we see the optimum temperature or 95% or more of the optimum temperature. So I took four different body temperatures between 25 degrees Celsius to 45 degrees Celsius with approximately 4 degrees Celsius intervals for 20 lizards, and I kept the lizards at a desired temperature for 1 hour using a 150 watt infrared lamp to heat the lizards and a water bath with ice packs to cool the lizards. Then I kept the lizards at the beginning of this racetrack, and these are 50 centimeter intervals, and I simulated the lizards so the lizards would run from the start of the racetrack to the end. This was captured at a 25 frames per second to measure the speed of the lizard. This is what I got. This is a generalized additive mix model, and from that I got the optimum temperature of the lizard, which was 39.8 degrees Celsius, and the B95 range was this. There was a significant inter-individual variation between the lizard, so that is something to keep that in mind. Now let's pull all of those variables together into one simple plot. So this is the B95 range, this is the preferred temperature, this is the voluntary maximum temperature, and this is the critical maximum temperature. This black line you see is the body temperature of the lizard. This is the temperature in the open, this is the temperature at the burrow entrance, and this is the temperature inside the burrows. So as you can see, burrows provide an exceptional buffer to the lizard, thermal buffer to the lizard, as if the temperatures don't exceed any of the thermal limits. And then, if you see the temperatures in the open, they're varying the most. But if you see the body temperatures, so the active period is for 13 hours from 7 a.m. to 8 p.m. And if you see the body temperatures of the lizard, they're for 11 hours, they're mostly inside the B95 range, where their fitness is maximized. But if you see the temperatures in the open, they are restricted to either burrow entrances or burrows for 6 hours in the open currently. So this data is basically for May, when the temperatures are the maximum. Now, another question is, will this lizard survive till 2100? And I'll try to answer that. So let's look at different scenarios, from plus 1.5 degrees Celsius to plus 5 degrees Celsius. And let's look at the best case scenario, that is CT max. So the lizards won't come outside if the temperatures in the open are over CT max. So if you see, currently it's 6 hours. But in the worst case scenario, and even in the best case scenario, the restriction is 7 hours. So there's one additional hour of restriction. If you see the burrow entrance, in the worst case scenario, you will see there's additional 3 hours of restriction. Right, so they won't be able to survive even at the burrow entrance, and they'll have to stay in the burrow for a very long time. And as you can see, there's no restriction within the burrows, which means that they're very comfortable within the burrows. But we don't need that, right? Because the lizards need to come out to do their daily activities such as forage and find mates and territory defense and so on, which the lizards won't be able to do for additional hours due to increasing temperatures. Now, I also predicted the decline in locomotive performance across years. What I saw that by 2100, even in the best case scenario, there will be a 2% decline. In an intermediate case scenario, there will be a 10% decline. And in the worst case scenario, there will be a 28% decline. So a combination of additional hours of activity restriction and decline in locomotive performance will be deadly for the lizards. So the conclusions of this study were that the lizard utilizes burrows to thermoregulate in this harsh environment. Temperature affects both activity pattern and locomotive performance of the lizard, and hours of activity and locomotive performance will decrease with climate warming. And the main takeaway message from my presentation is that given the current thermoregulatory strategy, this lizard won't be able to mitigate the impacts of projected climate warming. That's it. I'd like to thank the following. Thank you.
Thanks so much for finishing well within time. Can I have questions now?
Yeah, it's a nice presentation and a nice thoughtful qualities hard wiki. My one question is that most of these reptiles, they rely exclusively more on behavioral laboratories. Okay, so most of the frequency of retreating back to the burrow,
right,
it may increase because of rising the temperature.
Right.
So overall, what I personally feel that that component, I don't know whether you have included or not.
The rate of shuttling.
So that might be much more higher. You know, as soon as they got heated up, they will back to retreat to burrow,
right,
come back. So somewhere that component is a critical in the behavioral thermoregulation. So that's one component. And most of these animals, they have a tolerance, you know, what we can call the comfort zone or lower and upper critical temperature. Each species has its own, you know, profile, where the mammals have different, reptiles have different.
Right, right.
So you have to put that factor in your calculation. What is that LCT? As a lower critical, which they can tolerate, and upper critical, they can tolerate. That's the one thing. In the comfort zone, not the ambient temperature. That's the one thing I would suggest you. But you know, we do not know what is their comfort zone. You know, where without enhancing the, what I want to make the point, without enhancing the, any metabolic cost, you know, as the relationship, if you increase the TA, metabolic cost increases.
Right.
So without enhancing the metabolic cost, what comfort zone is like that?
Right, so that is the V95 range within which their fitness is maximum. So that's a proxy for the metabolic cost.
So that you get in the proxy, but somehow you get the literature from the, you know, lot of, you know, Ackerberg, and that they have done a lot of all this metabolic pathway. So try to see how that differs from the proxies. So that's one more thing, component. If you say CT is 49 degree,
right,
how animals maintain, you know, the temperature or the body metabolic pathways at 49 degrees Celsius? That's another.
They die at that temperature, like 49
degrees. No, but there's somewhere they die, because there are mechanisms people have reported.
Okay.
So somehow, you know, what I call is the brain sensitivity.
Right.
That temperature is being maintained by some of the convection, and you know, there are a lot of mechanisms people have reported. So that component also is missing.
Sure.
So these three things try to look for, and more behavioral thermoregulation is a critical frequency. I have seen, I have worked from the Thar desert to the semi-arid desert, and same species. The rate of frequency retreating to burrow is varying a lot from a semi-arid to the arid desert,
right,
just to regulate the body temperature. So that component you have to see in that context.
Okay.
Otherwise, a good presentation.
Thank you.
Good use of work.
Thank you.
As you got these prediction models,
right,
with respect to climate change, transfer of plastic?
Yes, sir. That's a great question, sir. So there are two components to this. First one is they definitely change their behavior, as in they'll stay inside burrows for a longer amount of time, which will affect their fitness. But another component is that these thermoregulators and these thermoregulators, higher thermal thresholds won't be able to develop because they'll just spend more time inside the burrows, and individuals with higher thermal tolerance won't get selected for because they're spending more time inside the burrows.
Yeah, that's why the species will evolve to live there.
Right, but then they won't be able to do it. Right.
So when you have this extreme daily, so they will also be consistent with the virus in the water day. So that's the first. So that's the first question that's about the virus. So these are both going side by side. And this is the day which you have to do. So do you think when you have to change models, like you need to be careful while seeing that this is
what happens? Right, right, of course.
And especially for the species. This was for a species like an apple, it doesn't work for an apple.
Mm-hmm.
This was for a species, for some other species, which was for a species, which would give us this. Maybe, for example, if you say that we can do it for a year, so maybe this one. Probably the depth of the population.
Yes, sir.
That's much easier than to work the apple.
Mm-hmm.
So, of course, that's a good one.
Yeah, definitely. Thank you, sir.
Avichala, it was a very nice presentation. In the beginning of your presentation, you had shown that you were studying two different sites, right?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So, I mean, with respect to the sites, I mean, my question is, did you find any differences in these?
No, sir, I included that in my analysis, but there was no difference between the sites in terms of physiology or the body temperature.
Okay. And the next aspect is, you know, in terms of the activity, in one slide you mentioned that the activities tend to be higher as temperature, you know, goes up to a certain point. So the activity of the particular species is usually for foraging or for, you know, those sort of, you know, actions. So my question to you is, how much, you know, of the temperature, okay, will it sort of, you know, take on or bear onto itself if it has to, you know, forage at a particular, these two different sort of sites.
Okay.
You know, it may be that temperatures are high, but forage quality or forage availability also may be good.
Okay.
You know, so is it willing to sort of bear that temperature, or is there any difference in terms of those, if you observe any differences in
that
aspect?
That's a very interesting question. So I think if you consider only CT max, outside that temperature they won't be able to exist at all, no matter what kind of foraging opportunities they have. But if you see other thermal limits, they might be a little more plastic.
There is a question came from Rajat. Rajat is asking that, is there any scenario of the near future where any form of greening or change in hydrology can alter this? If there is, then how do you think the user will be?
Right. So this might definitely change the operative temperature, which might reduce the impacts of climate warming. But also during my focal samples, what I saw is the lizards aren't using shade at all. So they're only going to their burrows, coming out, going back to their burrows. So that might, the behavior might not change, but overall operative temperatures in the open might change, which might definitely buffer the impact of higher temperatures.
Out of my I was just wondering that burrow temperature is surprisingly.
Yes, it's constant. Yeah.
So, is there anything known in literature how that is connected?
No, sir. I should observe, I mean, I should check it out, but I think it's mostly due to the structure of the burrow, which is like horizontal and then again horizontal, diagonal in a different direction. And it's 1 meter deep inside where the temperatures are really cool. So, that might, I mean, it's buffering from even colder temperatures, not only hot temperatures. Yeah, but I'll definitely explore that. Thank you. Right.
regarding the activity pattern, I'm just curious to know that your study period is very small. For about 3 months only you have collected the data.
Right.
But being reptiles, there is a shift towards the temperature.
Mm-hmm.
If the temperature is that, for example, during the summer, it can be shifted to either crepuscular or nocturnal. During the winter, it can be a diurnal. So those type of shifts also is there. So according to the temperature, definitely the lizard can behaviorally adapt itself to sustain this environment. So for predicting 49 degrees Celsius would affect or can go for the extinction, it's a kind of bias. That's what I think. Is there any clarification from you for this?
So you're saying that the limit, the physiological limit will change according to season?